to rape women, and a lot of things were happening in Kenya. This was a very tough time for Kenya. And at this time, I was only 10, so I had no idea what was happening. And while at my grandma's house, I remember it was like the 28th or the 29th, we left to go at night at 3 a.m. to go sleep in a hole because we were scared that people were going to come and burn our houses while we're sleeping during the night. We slept at that hole until around, like, later on, almost close to morning. We woke up, and then we went back to the house. I was sleeping with my cousin. Everything was fine, I remember. So days went by, and things weren't good. Things weren't getting bad. On the 31st of 2007, like, the whole country, we were scared. No one knew what was happening, because no one, like, the people, like, most of the youth and the people were out there killing people, like I said, burning houses and raping women. So we got scared, and everybody around the village were all scared. We left to go hide in a church. The church is called Kiambaa. It was KAG, Kenya's God, Assembly of God. We all went and we hid. Now, remember, this church is made out of wood. So we stayed there on the 31st. Everything was okay. Everything was good. I was 10, so I was hanging out with most of the kids. And we were all having fun. We were playing. The next day, on the 1st, we woke up. Well, actually, on the 31st, people went back to their houses and grabbed, like, mattresses. People came with bikes. People came with sufurias, what are called pots. And everybody was, like, coming with their stuff. I remember I went back to my shoshos. I got, like, 2 jackets on. I got 2 shorts on. And then we went back to the church that same night. We were sleeping at that church. There was no, like, we didn't carry mattresses. So I slept on the ground between 2 chairs. Slept that throughout the whole night. The next day, we woke up, us the kids, we went to play around, and then came back around like noonish for lunch. And as we came back, the women were making food. There was like ileti being made for the people. In Kenya, they have these seats that just like rose, and we were just playing games in there. And we heard rocks being thrown like at the church. So when we were inside, we were curious. So we went outside the church to check what was happening. And I remember I saw a bunch of people charging towards the church. It was mostly youth coming towards the church with like machetes, rocks, just throwing them. I got scared. I went back inside the church. My brother and sister were with me, but after that, they like disappeared. They left, they ran away. I went back inside the church with a couple people. And as soon as we went back, the people came just in time and they locked the doors. So that the church had 2 doors that opened wide and then 1 passed the door. They locked those 2 doors. They took people's bikes, people had brought bikes, they put them outside the door and they locked the doors to where you couldn't push them out. And then they took mattresses of most of the people that bought them, they put them around the church and they lit it on fire basically with us inside. With the whole thing, once they lit it on fire, everybody was trying to run for their lives. Everybody was just trying to get out. They have these small windows so you couldn't jump like 3 people at once. It was like whoever could jump out would jump out. And imagine, as soon as you jumped out, they were still outside. So it wasn't like you were guaranteed to leave after that. You could jump outside and be killed. No one knew. So everybody was out there jumping. I remember I saw my aunt inside the church and she had her baby on her and she was trying to get out. People were stepping on us. And the reason my hands got burned is because the church was made out of wood. So I was trying to protect myself from it. It was falling and the whole church was burning. And with the fire going, I was trying to get out. I remember one thing that is, I always say that it was God, because one thing I was inside with the flaming, it being orange, and the next thing I was outside the church. So I always believed that that was God that made it okay, or allowed me to be outside, because he knew that I had greatness in me, or he knew that I was gonna become something. I went outside, eventually I got outside the church, and then outside the church, as I walked out, I could see bodies, there were people dead. Around there, I was scared. I walked around the church, and as soon as I walked, I went around, and I was trying to go back to my grandma's house because I didn't know where else to go. I remember one of the people that were doing the killings asked me, he said, if I want to die, then I go back to my grandma's house, but if I want to live, I better keep walking where everyone else is walking. And then I chose to walk where everyone else was walking. As I was walking, I came across my sister and my aunt, my other aunt, it was a different aunt. And then my sister looked at me, and she was like, oh my God. She was like, should we tell him what happened? Then my aunt was like, no, we shouldn't tell him what happened. And then I was walking with them for a while, but then they were walking too slow, so I walked fast. I remember that day I was thirsty. I was super thirsty, but they had people that were outside their houses giving waters. As you walk for a while, we We walked for about 2 miles, and then I didn't know I was burned this whole time. I didn't know anything. I wasn't in pain. I was okay. I was trying to get to where everyone else was going so I could find somebody that I know. Main road, and as soon as we got to the main road, there was a pickup truck giving people rides, most of the people who were burnt, and then the other people were still walking. I remember I saw my grandma there along the line, and she saw me. She was yelling at me. She was crying, trying to come towards me. Her friends put her back, and then I climbed on the pickup truck. There were some other people in the truck as well that were burned. I remember there was a girl that we came with too. She was screaming in there. We eventually got to the hospital. My dad saw me. He stayed with me. But before that, my uncle was the one who was communicating with my dad to figure out, because my uncle was in Kiambaa as well. So we all got to the hospital. He was there. He came. And then he was communicating with my dad, trying to get my dad to come. Because my dad came. He stayed with me for a while. And then communicating with my mom, and he would tell my mom that I'm not burned. I'm burned, but just a little bit, so that my mom doesn't have to be scared about what happened. And later on, my mom eventually ended up coming. She did not recognize me when she saw me. The only thing that gave me away was the shorts that I was wearing. She knew it was me. And I wasn't like really well, so I was speaking to her because I couldn't see. So the whole time I was speaking to my mom, I was speaking to her, and just, I could hear her voice, but I didn't really know she was there. And I stayed in the hospital for 3 months. I ended up staying in the hospital for 3 months. I was having surgery in and out almost every day. The hospital wasn't really the best hospital. There were days that I would have surgery, and when you're having surgery, you can't eat. And I would have surgeries, and then I would be scheduled to have surgery, but the days of surgery, like at night, they would cancel my surgeries and I haven't ate, and they would reschedule it for tomorrow, and then tomorrow would come, and sometimes they would cancel the surgeries, so I'd have to eat like late and only one meal. I got skinny, and I would sometimes like hop, not that I needed, but I would use a wheelchair to like go around, but it wasn't that I needed it. I wasn't walking right, and I stayed in the hospital for 3 months, wasn't getting better. They decided to move us to a different hospital, which is called Kiambaa Hospital. They moved us there. I stayed in that hospital for 7 months. It was a better hospital. They had missionaries coming from the U.S. to come and treat people. I had quite a better experience there. I had people teach me. I knew a little English, and missionaries would come and teach us math, English, and all that, the subjects. Stayed there for 7 months. I was having some surgery in and out. We got discharged. I went to a boarding school, stayed for 8 months, and as I was there, people came together in Kenya, and they were trying to raise 30 million shillings for us to come to abroad and to come and get treatment. The people came, and then they did their thing. We were having fundraisers all the time. We were moving from the school that I was going was in a place called Naivasha, so we would go to Nairobi almost every weekend to go and do fundraisers and go for press so that people could fundraise and give us money so that we could come to the U.S. and get treatment at an okay amount of money. But before we got to America, before like a few weeks before, the Kenyan government took over, and then they decided that they would help us out. We got to meet the president, we talked, and then they agreed to help us out, so they did help us out for a while. I came here with only my mom. It was only the women that could come, so we came with three families, but four people. I was the only guy. There were three girls, myself, and we all lived in one house. I was having surgery here. I've had about 24 surgeries here in America since I've been here, and about almost 100 in Kenya. And then I remember one of the surgeons there's a surgeon that failed when I was having surgery. I was in an operation room, and then my heart stopped out of nowhere. It just stopped. Trying to put me back. There's a bigger hospital next to the hospital I was in. People came from the other hospital, and they were like pumping my heart. And I remember I always say this, like I couldn't feel, well, they were pumping me, but I couldn't move because I was in anesthesia. So I could see people moving around, but I couldn't move. And I really thought I was dead because I couldn't see. And everybody was out there just walking around. Eventually they did end up covering me. I ended up staying in ICU for about 5 days after that because I couldn't walk. I had tubes. I was being fed by, I had water, like pipes going through, giving me water so that I could continue to live. started practicing how to walk again because I had forgotten it. Like every time I would wake up to walk, I'd feel dizzy. So, and that's one of the things that actually scared me, because I thought I'd never be able to walk again. I had to start using those things to start walking again. And eventually I did end up walking. I got moved back to the downstairs ward, and I stayed there for a while. I got discharged. And to keep the story short, I still continue to have surgery, because the surgeries here in America, they were different than in Kenya. So I was able to go to school. I would have surgery, and these things that were put in my head and on my neck, they call tissue expanders. It's like a balloon. They put the balloon in you, and they grow skin. Like they, so I would have injections every week to make the balloon grow bigger, so that they grow skin and keep moving it to where I was burned, so that it looks like it's a better skin that grew. And eventually, I was going to school. I went to school. I did great. Graduated high school actually recently with a 3.5. So that was good. Fight for asylum around 2012, around something like that. We ended up getting it. My brother and sister came 5 years later. My dad then joined us a year after they came. So my brother and sister have been in the United States for about 3 years, and my dad has been here for about 2 years. We all live in Sacramento. What else did I miss? We're all good. It's been hard throughout this whole time. I can never take anything for granted. And I see life differently now. I value life, and I thank God. I look at the little things that He does, and I appreciate Him. I always give Him glory for each and everything that He does in my life. And if it wasn't for Him, I wouldn't be here. And I believe that He has a plan for me to prosper, like He says in Jeremiah. I'm very grateful for each and everything He does, and I pray that you all will be. And I pray that anytime you go through something small or big, always know that there's something at the end, and God is always with you, and He's doing that for something. And I hope I've been able to inspire you with my story. I want to do this wholeheartedly as to the Lord and not unto men. My vision: to own the best media company that I will run with a team of talented videographers, editors, photographers, and event coordinators who have the same passion and interest that I have. With this platform, I will mentor those with the same passion towards what it is that I do while meeting people's needs and making sure they get more than what they request. And then my passion is Chekatv and comedy. And with that, I want to grow people and give people opportunities to make it and be big stars.